So in our scripture passage today, we have three characters. We have the Pharisee, we have the woman, and we have Jesus. Now, it was said that the woman lived in the same town as the Pharisee, that she was sinful, and she came to the Pharisee's house because she heard that Jesus was there. I want you to picture this woman as a lost sheep. A sheep that is being led or has been led by an evil shepherd, leading her to places that are harmful to her and to others, leading her to pastures of sin. This lost sheep desired a better shepherd. But the better shepherd, the Pharisee, did not welcome her into the flock. We see from the attitude of the Pharisee that he had contempt for her, not willing to overlook her past sins, but instead counted them against her. He was rude, and his rudeness stemmed from self-righteousness. I mean, for after all, he earned the title of Pharisee, and he never would indulge in those sins. The Pharisee was set in his ways, unwilling to change his perspective and unwilling to behave in any way that he considered beneath him. He therefore did not perform basic tasks of hospitality towards Jesus, his guest. So we have the woman who is following an evil shepherd, who wants to follow a good shepherd, but the good shepherd she is looking to shows nothing but contempt for her. She is trapped in the pasture of sin. But then she hears about, or perhaps witnesses for herself, this new shepherd, the best shepherd, named Jesus. And she goes to him and finds the acceptance that she is looking for. Not the acceptance of her sin, mind you, but rather acceptance of her as a human being, of one with intrinsic value. A shepherd who is willing to lead her out of the pasture of sin and into the green pastures of love. Jesus points out the difference between the Pharisee and the woman and the reason for that difference by telling the story of two men who had their debt forgiven, one a small debt, the other a larger debt. He then asks the Pharisee, who will love the debt forgiver more? To which the Pharisee correctly answered, the one forgiven the most debt. Jesus concludes his teaching by saying, whoever has been forgiven little loves little. Jesus ties the ability to love well with the degree by which someone realizes their sinfulness and their need for forgiveness. The root cause of self-righteousness and the rude, self-seeking, angry attitude and actions that flow from it. The root cause is not recognizing the amount of debt you have been forgiven. This is why I lovingly call you all wretches from time to time, to remind you that without Christ, you are and were a wretch. The more you understand your sin and your great capacity to sin, the more you will love your Savior, and the more you will love others. The woman was fully aware of her sin. And she couldn't demonstrate her love for Jesus enough. Self-righteousness, with its rude, self-seeking, and easily angered attitude, is the antithesis of love. I want to show you a video that will put this more into a contemporary context.
Hey, Square.
I am not a square.
I think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
What they need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down, man, slow down.
Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
Love is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. In the movie The Jesus Revolution, Kelsey Grammer plays Chuck Smith. Chuck Smith, if you don't know who he is, started Calvary Chapel, which today has over 1,700 churches worldwide. But it was a different story back in 1969. Chuck then only had a congregation of about 25 people. And they all were very upset about where the culture was headed. There was a great divide in the country at that time between the status quo and a movement of the younger generation who called themselves hippies. The church was repulsed by the movement, and rightly so, for it promoted unbiblical lifestyles, sexual immorality and drug use. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll was their motto. The hippie movement, on the other side, had a disdain for authority, which included the government as well as the church. They dressed provocatively, with women wearing miniskirts that didn't cover much, and they burned their bras. They protested, created unrest, and they didn't wear shoes. I remember it was about that time. My mom would drive my dad to the train station. I would be tucked in the back seat. And on the way to the train station, we see the kids walking to school. And my dad, in Archie Bunker fashion, would say, "Look at that girl. She might as well go to school naked." I also remember wanting to be cool like my hippie older sister and go barefoot everywhere in the summer. But I would always stub my toe and it would bleed all over the place. And then I'd have to put a Band-Aid on my toe. I was a square. The church blamed the hippies for destroying the moral fabric of the nation. And the hippies labeled the church as hypocritical, preaching love but showing none. Both, sadly, were right. The attitude of the church was portrayed perfectly by Smith and his elders. And the attitude of the hippies was portrayed by Smith's daughter. Smith saying that they needed a bath. The daughter calling him out on judging them without even knowing them. And Smith responded, "When God walks in here and brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about." Well, God was up to the challenge. And he introduced a hippie to Smith, a hippie who found Jesus and left the sinful parts of the movement. And he had a love for his generation and wanted them to know about Jesus. But he found no church door open to them. And Smith was moved by the man's testimony. And Smith himself repented and then decided that his church would be the one with open doors, accepting all of them, not affirming the hippie lifestyle, but rather preaching the truth and love and forgiveness, drawing those kids away from the evil shepherd and pointing them to the loving shepherd. Love is not rude. Like the Pharisee in our scripture, Smith in the beginning and his elders were rude. They were rude toward the hippies. And this rudeness stemmed from self-righteousness. They were behaving in such a way that they had little regard for people who were different from them. They had the attitude of, "We're better than you." They had either forgotten about the sinful state that they were rescued from, or they just didn't understand the gospel. And like the Pharisee, maybe they thought it was their good works that got them in good standing with God. And the result of their rudeness widened the divide between the church and a group of people in need of help. A group of people that the church is commanded to reach. I think John MacArthur rightly said, he said this, self-righteous rudeness by Christians can turn people away from Christ before they have a chance to hear the gospel. The messenger can become a barrier to the message. If people do not see the gentleness of Christ clearly in us, they are less likely to see him clearly in the gospel that we preach. Love is not self-seeking. The problem of many of the churchgoers, then and perhaps today as well, they didn't accept the hippies into the congregation because they brought with them a different way of communicating, a different style of dress, different music. The hippies didn't do things the right way. The men didn't wear jackets and ties, and they all needed a haircut. Many women didn't wear dresses. They didn't sing hymns, and they didn't use the organ. Their dirty bare feet were messing up the carpet. The churchgoers were self-seeking. They wanted what was best for them. They wanted their preferences and their practices to be honored. But I loved Smith's response. His response to the dirty feet criticism is he set up a bowl of water and washed all of their feet as they came into the sanctuary. His self-righteousness dissolved into humility. The Pharisee wouldn't wash Jesus' feet. The woman wiped his feet clean with her hair and tears. Love is not easily angered. The elders got angry when they didn't get their way. And most of them left the church. But love does not get angry at others when they say or do something that displeases us, or when they prevent us from having our own way. As Christians, Christ is our example. And we find this example in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 through 24. Peter wrote this: "To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example." Here's the example: "that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed." The person who is intent on having his own way is easily provoked, easily angered. In all of this, many in the church then and many in the church now are making the same mistake. They are not acting in love. The Apostle Paul tells us that this is not a battle against flesh and blood, but rather it is a spiritual battle. A spiritual battle. Spiritual warfare. But we don't listen to Paul. No, we, in our easily provoked self-righteousness, turn our weapons against other sheep, other flesh and blood. Rather than presenting the gospel in love, aiming to turn sheep away from their evil shepherd and towards the good and perfect shepherd, we instead shun them. We push them away. We're like eighth graders in lunchroom saying, "You can't sit with us." I keep looking, but I can't find the passage where Jesus tells us to fight the battle against evil for him. I can't find it. On the contrary, I see, love your neighbor as yourself. Love your enemy. As far as it is up to you, be at peace with all men. Always be prepared to give an answer to the hope within you with gentleness and respect. Oh, overcome evil with good. But why? Why can't I fight now? Because vengeance and wrath are his, not ours. There will come a day when evil will be routed, but that isn't today, as far as we know. We are now in the time of grace. We are in the time of the church, where the Lord is patient, not wanting any to perish. People will eventually perish. Evil people. People who reject God's love and grace through Christ. Sadly, they will perish. But we, however, are unable to discern who they are. We are not capable of separating the goats from the sheep. Only God is. We are not capable of judging justly. Only God is. And that is why we are told to preach the gospel to all, to everyone, without judgment, and to love. In other words, not have actions or attitudes that become a barrier to the gospel from being heard. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Yes, our culture, our world, is filled with much evil. And it seems like we see more of it now than ever in our lifetime. But God still sits on the throne. He is still sovereign. He is not asleep at the wheel expecting us to take it. Rather, he is waiting for us to behave as if we truly trust him. We, like Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit within us, can show love to those who commit evil against us. If we trust in the one who judges justly. God wants us, the church, in this period of grace to overcome evil with good. Our natural sin-natured self tells us to fight. Fighting is easy. We just fall right into that. Lashing out in anger, that's easy. Not retaliating and trusting God has a better way? That's difficult. But that's what the church is called to do. From 1969 to 1972, there was a huge revival called the Jesus Revolution, where many young people who had previously been misled, many young people who needed help, found Jesus, turned to him, left the evil shepherd and joined Jesus, the perfect shepherd. And perhaps God wants to do that again. It's been over 50 years. And we've been praying for a revival. We have been praying for a movement of the Holy Spirit. But let me tell you something, nothing squelches the Holy Spirit like self-righteousness. Maybe we should start praying that God would remove anything within us that may be hindering that revival. And then maybe we'll see the Spirit move. I would like to be a part of that. Wouldn't you? I'll conclude this with a video of the baptism scene from the movie, which is followed by actual footage from back in 1969 through 1970. And as you watch this video, I'd like you to think of two words. What if?
I'm just saying, why is it going to prove?
Right, it's just water. It's, why are you freaking out?
I'm not freaking out. Okay, I'm freaking out a little bit.
You're going to be fine.
Do you fully accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and
Savior? Is it?
You are transformed. Your heart, your soul, your life will never be the same. You're welcome.
How'd that feel?
You'll see.
Hi. Greg, right?
Yeah.
I've been praying for this moment since I first met you. Have you decided?
I don't know.
You want to decide right now?
Yeah. Yeah, I do.
And pray with me.
Lord Jesus,
I know I'm a sinner.
Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner.
But you are the Savior of the world.
You are the Savior of the world.
I ask you to come into my life.
I ask you to come into my life.
I repent for my sins.
I repent from all my sins.
And I accept you as my Lord and Savior, my God and friend.
And I accept you as my Lord and Savior, my God and my friend.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Greg, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. How do you feel?
Alive.
Oh, thank you.
Oh.
Please pray with me. Father God, again, we thank you for this day. I thank you for loving us so much that you sent your son to die for us. I pray that every person here understands that great gift and has received that gift of salvation because of your great love. I pray that we may leave this place recognizing that we are sinners in need of a Savior. And so is everybody that's out there. We have just been blessed to know the Good Shepherd now. Help us to steer others towards Him. In Jesus' name, amen.